Praise God. Thank you for joining us tonight for Bible study. We hope and pray that God has been good to you, has been good for you, and that he has blessed you mightily, and that the prayer that you put forth before him, that he is beginning to bring into fruition. And if he is not, we pray that your faith does not fail just because it has not manifested yet. Before we get into God's word, let's go to him in prayer. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, how we thank you for being merciful, for being kind, for being gracious, for being our Father, our Redeemer, for being all that you are unto us. We ask, God, as your children, that you would allow us to be able to not only just teach your word, but to hear your word and become doers of your word. We love you, God. We honor you. We bless and reverence your holy and righteous name. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Praise God.
Praise God.
So tonight, we have a very interesting bit of scripture to deal with. And we're going to come out of 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 10. I'm going to read you two translations tonight from King James and from the Wycliffe Bible. And our topic for tonight was the root of all evil, the root of all evil. And it's coming from 1 Timothy chapter 10, verse 6. And it says this, King James Version, "For the love of money is the root of all evil, which some covet after they have erred from the faith and have pierced themselves through many sorrows." Now, here's a different translation. This is the Wycliffe Bible. The Wycliffe Bible says, "The root of all evil is covetousness, which some men coveting err from the faith and besetting themselves with so many sorrows." Praise God, that's it. With so many sorrows. So that's the Wycliffe Version. The King James Version said, "For the love of money is the root of all evil." The Wycliffe Version says, "The root of all evil is covetousness." So there's a debate. There's a debate that we have here. We have a debate whether to determine which translation is actually accurate. Closer to the original translation from the Greek to English. The Wycliffe Bible, okay, let's start with the King James. The King James Bible, which was translated around 1511. The Wycliffe and the Tyndale Bible both were translated, earlier translations from 1358, and the other one was after that. The King James adopted some of the translations from the Tyndale and the Wycliffe. Both the Wycliffe and the Tyndale both say, "For the root of all evil is covetousness." King James found a way to add the root of money, the love of money, is the root of all evil. Mm-hmm. However, King James was translated from the Wycliffe and the Tyndale. So we have to ask ourselves a question. How can that be? One scripture is two different translations. And it's very simple. Is that the King James has it partially correct. Money can be a cause of evil, but money is not the root of all evil. For the root, by definition, the root is the cause or the occasion by which anything brought about. It's the source. So considering that money is a symptom, covetousness has to be the diagnosis, has to be the source. Money is a symptom of working, labor, inheritance, whatever. It's a symptom of working with your hands or however you labor. It's a symptom. It is not the diagnosis. So therefore, the King James has it partially correct. But the correct translation for this particular text, and we've heard this text many, many times, but in fact, it's probably preached throughout churches, is that the love of money is the root of all evil. The true context of what was translated from Greek should have been, "For the root of all evil is covetousness." Praise God. So if covetousness is the root of all evil, let's define what covetousness is. Maria, you got that? Let's define what covet it.
Covetousness is the desire or the want for something that is not yours. So it could be money, but it could also be many other things.
There's a scripture. The scripture says in Exodus 20 and 17, that's one of the commandments out of the 611. We say 10, but it's over 600 and something. 600 and something Mosaic laws that was given to Moses to the people of Israel. Exodus chapter 20, verse number 17. And it says this, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is his neighbor's. Notice it did not just mention his money. It mentioned everything that you should not covet. And then if we go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15, right, lady? Queen Dylan? Ephesians chapter 5, if you got it, you don't have it, I got it. Ephesians chapter 5, sorry.
Ephesians
5 and 15, what does that say?
Be careful then how you live. Is that it?
Yeah, no rich man, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
5 and 15?
Oh, no,
I think it's 5 and 5, I'm sorry.
5 and 5.
5 and 5.
Okay. For this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man as an adulterer, shall have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God.
Read it one more time.
For this you can be sure of, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man is an idolater, shall have any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God.
So the New American Standard and the King James would have said, instead of greedy, would have said
covetous.
Notice it did not say any rich man, any man of wealth, any man of high prestige, but a greedy or covetousness. So covetousness has to be the root of all evil. So since the root means that it has, that is the source, we have to go all the way back to see where this source came from. And we're going to have to do that by traveling all the way back to the garden. When you look at what happens in Genesis with the serpent and Eve, dealing with the serpent, when the serpent was describing what would happen if she ate of the fruit, she began to lust after it. She began to desire it. She began to want it. She began to covet after having the same powers as God.
That's right.
So this is the source, the desire of her heart to be more like God. So when she ate of the fruit and she gave it to her husband, covetousness began as one of the sins began to enter into Adam and Eve. And then when they conceived and had Cain and Abel, the Bible says that when Cain and Abel were presenting their sacrifice, their fruits, their first fruits of the labor to God, that Cain was wroth because God was pleased with Abel's sacrifice. But God says, if you just do better,
that's right,
I'll be just as satisfied with you. But instead, Cain began to covet the response that was given to Abel by God because of the sacrifice. So instead of doing better, covetousness crept in and gave Cain a murdering spirit, and he killed his brother. So if the root of a thing begins with covetousness, the seeds that it produces are things like an evil, a jealous, a wicked, a murdering spirit.
Mm-hmm.
All those things come out of covetousness. And we can see that right in the first, besides disobedience, after she disobeyed, the result, the diagnosis of this sin was covetousness. And then that birthed out into the nation, and then we all are privy to have covetousness creep into our lifestyles as we are children of the first Adam and Eve, even with the flood being washed, that didn't change the nature of man. They were still the seeds of Adam and Eve. So Wycliffe, in the Tyndale version of this particular translation, covetousness is the root of all evil, has to be the correct translation for what Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6. Mm-hmm. Now, don't let that discourage you about the Word of God. That's why he says that you have to study and show yourself approved, so that we can understand that even while it goes through the hands of man, that God can give us the wisdom to be able to know what's right and what isn't right. And we don't know exactly why the King James would have chose to select one word to describe as the root of all evil. But we know that he did. Now, if we look back and look at the historical evidence around what was going on during that time, there was always a need for money. And it could happen to be that if I tell you that money isn't good, that you would be so reluctant just to give it away and not even question it, and it come all back to the king. So who knows what the motive was to just make one of these a portion of evil. But covetousness is the root. Because if I began to covet, if I began to desire whatever is not mine, I will do anything to obtain it. Which means I might kill, I might steal, I might lie, I might do whatever I have to do in order to get that thing that God didn't say was mine. But because I seen you with it, I want it, so I have to do whatever I have to do it. So the root of all evil is covetousness. Now, why can't it be money? The scripture says that God gives us the increase to obtain,
gives us
the ability to obtain wealth.
That's right.
So how can wealth, which is a relationship to money, whether that be more property, more businesses,
better health,
how can that be a bad thing if God gave us the ability to obtain it? It can't be. It's like an oxymoron. Jesus was dealing with, he gave a parable of his servants that had, he gave them coins. And the one that, those two that increased those coins, he was well pleased with. And the one that did nothing with it, he took it and he gave it to the other ones that had increases. So how can money be a bad thing? The Bible says that money is a defense.
That's right, Ecclesiastes.
Ecclesiastes, what verse is that?
It's Ecclesiastes 7:12.
Ecclesiastes.
For money is a defense, for wisdom is a defense, mm-hmm. and money is a defense. But the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth life to them that have it.
So with money being a defense, coupled with wisdom, mm-hmm. right, we become good stewards.
That's right.
Over money. Mm-hmm. So a defense with money means is that it will ward off. Imagine just playing basketball. Everybody knows what basketball is, right? Defending somebody from shooting a goal. Money defends things like poverty, issues with I need to pay my bills. I have to buy food. I can do whatever
so I
desire
have
to do.
Steal.
That's right.
Because sin begets more sin.
Sin begets more
so
sin.
So if I don't have things, then I start eyeing other people's things. So money is a defense, and his desire is that you prosper.
Is that you prosper.
But it's also that you trust him for the increase and not in your own might, or that you begin to look at other people's things.
Right, because we look at the ministry that Jesus had, and he doesn't describe his monetary wealth. Mm-hmm. But it does declare that he understands the principles of money, as we have seen him tell one of the disciples, go to the lake, mm-hmm. pull out the coin from the fish, and go pay your taxes mm-hmm. with it.
Yeah.
And yours and mine.
That's right.
So he understands the value, the defense of money. So how can money be the root of evil, the source of evil? Money can't be the source of evil. Money is a symptom of covetousness. Hmm. The symptom of covetousness, which means because of the greed and the eyeing and the wanting of other people's things, now I entered into this realm of a wicked and perverse nation. So we've got a question. How do we do it?
So how do we not covet? A few weeks ago, you taught on stop looking at other people's blessings, coming out of Psalm 78, mm-hmm. Verse 21 through 30. And it talked about how God was mad with or upset with the Israelites because they weren't thankful. Verse 21 reads, "When the Lord heard them, he was very angry. His fire broke out against Jacob, and his wrath rose against Israel. For they did not believe in God or trust in his deliverance." How do we not covet? We keep our eyes off of other people's blessings because we don't know what they had to go through. Outsiders looking in didn't know what the Israelites had to go through. And maybe the Israelites even forgot, God just brought me out of this.
Yeah.
He'll take me through this next thing. A lot of times when we're going through, we're only focused on that situation instead of everything that God has brought us from, when those in fact should be our stepping stones that build our faith, that say, he brought me from that, he will surely bring me through this. So we keep our eyes off other people's blessings. But then we seek God first, because right. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and everything else. Mm-hmm. I'll take care of all that. All that other stuff is going to be added unto you. And then we acknowledge him in all of our ways. The word of God promises that if we acknowledge him, that he would give us the desires of our hearts. Not necessarily that everything that we want. But our desires are going to change because things are in perspective now.
Right.
When we start seeking him first and acknowledging him, then our desires change because our desires line up with his will.
Right.
Which isn't necessarily to own Fort Knox, right. You know. So we have to make sure that we are seeking him because, yes, money is a defense. But if money lost its value tomorrow,
right.
What would it matter? How many zeros were in your account.
Right.
But if you have this great relationship with God where you trust him for anything, he said that he would have men given to your bosoms. He would call them to give into your bosom. So if that's correct, then in tomorrow money meant nothing. That means that he would just let the store drop food off,
mm-hmm.
or the electric company keep my lights on, or whatever it is. That's men giving into your bosom. So we have to make sure that we keep our eyes off other people's things because we don't know what it costs them. Right. And we don't know what it would cost us.
Right.
We say we want different things, but what is it going to cost us?
Right.
So we have to keep things in perspective and trust in God because he knows how to give his children good gifts.
Praise God.
Praise God.
So we were looking at, Mariel was researching the original, when the Greek or the Hebrew was translated from the ancient Paleo, and this is what she discovered with the original word that describes covetousness.
So the first symbol, the few words that connect to it is tent, wall, or fence, or separation. So I basically broke that down, and what I believe it is saying is that it separates us between us and God, which we all know is never a good thing because we don't want any separation with God because then we're not following his will and we can't walk in the path that we're supposed to. And from that, it can cause us to be more susceptible to the enemy's tricks. And then the second symbol, it means water or chaos. So after we're already separated from God, then we're away from him and not in tune with the Holy Spirit, and it causes chaos in our lives,
mm-hmm.
and he is our shepherd, and so how are we supposed to walk throughout life without God leading us? And because we know we can't do it on our own, we can't lead ourselves without God, it's not possible. And then the last symbol is tent, door, or pathway. So the last like stage, for lack of better words, would be that the covet thoughts is you opening the door of evilness, and you're on that pathway now and fully separated from God.
Hmm. Praise God. So those symbols are the Dalet, the Chet, and the Mem. So I'll post those so that you can see them. And they're from the Paleo Ancient ancient Hebrew, the picture graphs that the actual Hebrew words were translated from is which we get the word covet from, made of three parts, as you said. But as we discussed, that the translator that most people use, translation that most people use, is the King James. However, King James got his translation from the two that translated primarily first, which is the Wycliffe and the Tyndale, and both of them declare that for the root of all evil is covetousness and not money. Money is a symptom. Money is a cause of working for labor. Covetousness produces people to eye people that have money. It's not the effects of having money. It's what people do because you have money. It's the covetousness. So just for FYI, the root of all evil is covetousness. And we can determine that by going all the way back to the beginning where the first diagnosis was announced or proclaimed to Adam and Eve and Cain and Abel in the garden because of what Eve saw and because of what Cain saw. Both of them desired to have something that was neither theirs, which began the coveted spirit. Be careful that you don't have a Cain spirit and that you're constantly looking at what other people have and that you desire to be like them. As Lady Gwendolyn said, you don't know what it's going to cost them and you don't know what they have to go through to obtain that. But as she said, you have to seek God. And seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness and all these things that he will add unto you. So with that, continue to study. It's important for us to study the Word of God, as there are several translations, and some of those translations have removed various words. Some of them have removed various verses. Mm-hmm. Even with them applying a footnote, they've removed verses. So it's important for you to get back as close to what it's supposed to be as possible. Even though 90% of us can't read Hebrew or Greek, and we don't have the original scrolls to do it anyway, it's important that you begin, that you pray, and you ask God to make spiritual sense out of what doesn't make sense. So as we look at this text, and we know that God is a provider, we know that he doesn't mind providing. As he always says, he owns the cattle on a thousand hills, and that's money. That's wealth, however you divvy it out. It may not be a coin, but it can ascertain other objects of value. As Jesus said, that we shall live the life of abundance. Now, that includes good health, good spiritual habits, joy, the fruits of the Spirit, but it also includes money. You know, so be not deceived, for God is not. He is not mocked. Let us pray. God, we thank you, Almighty Master, for constantly showing us things in your word that we can learn from. We ask that you would just continue to teach us by your Holy Spirit, that we will know the difference between your word and man's opinion, that we will trust in you and not lean not unto our own understanding. We acknowledge that you are God. And before we were, you were, and when we leave, God, you still will be. So help us, Master, as we are traveling through to continue to become more like you on a daily basis. Let not our eyes be fixed on something that doesn't belong to us, but let us trust and believe that you will, God, open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that are signed with our names on it, and that way we don't have to look at our neighbors and have to desire for theirs, but we'll trust you that as you bless them, that you will bless us. We honor you, we adore you, and we love you. We ask that you forgive us of all sins that we've committed, both now and in the future. May you wipe our transgressions clean, God, from all spiritual manifestation and all natural things. It's in the almighty name of Jesus we pray. Praise God.
Praise God.
So, Trinity, we'll see you Sunday at 11:15. For all those others, go find you a place to go worship. God bless you. Good night. Yeah, so Jay, we don't say.